Good morning, everyone. How's everybody doing? Thank you for being here for our second week of Advent. So we're going to get started this morning, and welcome to you guys watching online here at The Journey at Fountain City United Methodist Church. We're going to do a song you've probably never heard in church before. Go figure that, huh? Between Bob Dylan and making Martin Scorsese references, I'm kind of living on the edge sometimes. And Quentin Tarantino, yeah. So let's stand up. And everybody knows this song, so I need you to sing it, okay? Here we go. Rocking around the Christmas tree at the Christmas party hall. Mistletoe hung where you can see, every couple tries to stop. Rocking around the Christmas tree, let the Christmas spirit breathe. Later we'll have some pumpkin pie, we'll do some caroling. You will get a sentimental feeling when you hear voices singing, let's be jolly, deck the halls with boughs of holly. Rocking around the Christmas tree, have a happy holiday. Everyone dancing merrily in a new old-fashioned way. Halls with boughs of holly, rocking around the Christmas tree, have a happy holiday. Everyone dancing merrily in the new old-fashioned way. All right. Y'all may be seated. Running really slow. One heart, one mind, one body. All this we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. check that and make sure.
Now we're working.
Hey.
Hey, you can hear me clearly now.
Yes.
Turn it off before I sing, please. Still not off.
We are getting there. This iPad is running so slow this morning. And y'all lift up Jeremy Stewart. He usually runs the sound. His grandmother died, and he's on his way back from Mississippi. So we'll lift him up in prayers. Let's stand back up. We're going to sing some more Christmas tunes. First Noel.
The first Noel, the angel did say, was to certain poor shepherds in fields as they lay, in fields where they lay keeping their sheep on a cold winter's night. That was so deep. Noel, 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 Noel. Born is the King of Israel. Looked up and saw a star shining in the east beyond them far, and to the earth it gave great light, and so it continued both day.
So this song is normally a female singing song. It's Mary, Did You Know? But I found a good version for a guy a couple of years ago. And here we go. Mary, Did You Know?
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? The child that you deliver will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to the blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? And when you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God. The deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy one day rule the nation? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? The sleeping child you're holding is the great I Am. Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? The sleeping child you're holding is the great I Am.
Amen. Thank you, Father. All right. Y'all can sit down.
Good morning.
Morning, everyone.
Join in hearing the word of our Lord for this Sunday, for this second Sunday of Advent, the Sunday of peace. I will be reading from Malachi chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. See, I am sending my messenger to prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant in whom you delight, indeed, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. But who can endure the day of his coming, and who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like fuller's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he will purify the descendants of Levi and refine them like gold and silver until they present offerings to the Lord in righteousness. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasing to the Lord as in the days of old and as in former years.
For many of us, the call to head home is one of joy and hope. We can't wait to reconnect with family, with history and tradition, with a wonderful time of freedom and loving support. We can't wait to go home.
There are those who fear going home, however, and there are times when going home brings back memories that are not so good, not so healing. We are reminded of when we didn't fit in, when we didn't measure up, when we weren't loved like we needed to be loved. Home can be a difficult place for some.
The prophet Malachi tells us that even when we are at the hottest of fires, there is presence whom can make us better. We can refine and purify. John the Baptist tells us that the road home is always under construction, mountains leveled and valleys filled in, to make smooth the path that leads us to our true destination, where we can live in peace and unity with all.
We light these candles, the candles of hope and the candle of peace, as a sign of our assurance that though the road is hard, we believe it is worth the journey. It is time to go home.
Hear me now. As chair of the Staff Parish Relations Committee here at Down City United Methodist Church, I have two staff position announcements to make. First is regarding Maxine Engel, our receptionist, and it is with mixed emotions that we announce that she is retiring, and she has been the smiling face and telephone voice who has greeted members and visitors to the church for the past 12 years. Maxine has faithfully facilitated communication between the staff, the congregation, visitors, and vendors. Her contributions will always be valued and remembered. A drop-in retirement party will be held on Monday, December 20th, from 10:30 to 12 in Wesley Hall. Notes and gifts of appreciation can be sent to the church office and marked for Maxine or brought to the retirement party. We will recognize Maxine in the 11 o'clock worship service on December 26. Please join me in giving thanks to Maxine for being such a faithful part of our church for 12 years and congratulate her on the retirement. The second announcement is regarding Daniel Doubleday, who has been our youth director here at Fountain City United Methodist Church for 8 years. In consultation with the pastors, staff parish relations committee, Daniel has decided to resign as our youth director. And this is not effective immediately. He will be here to help facilitate a smooth transition to a new director. We have begun a nationwide search for Daniel's replacement. So I ask you all to lift up our youth ministry, lift up Daniel and his family as they enter in this transition. No change is easy. All kinds of stress. But we want to honor and recognize Daniel's contributions and offer our prayers as he goes into his next ministry area. Thank you very much.
I have spent a lot of time with Daniel over the last few weeks, and it was a decision he came to on his own, a decision that did not come lightly. As you all know, Daniel has 5 children and lives in West Knoxville, so this has been a difficult time for his family traveling back and forth, and I think
He's looking forward to what opportunities face him next. And I am so proud of the work he's done here at Fountain City United Methodist Church. And I'm very grateful for Daniel and look forward to what comes next for him, because he has many talents and skills that will certainly allow him to thrive as God continues to call him. And I'm also so grateful for Maxine. For those of you who know Maxine, you may not know this. She's a bit of a jokester and kind of mean sometimes in like a funny way. So I'm going to really miss getting insulted when I come through the door on Monday morning. I'm not kidding, you know. I miss those little jabs. They're quick and you don't expect them because she's quiet. So it's quite funny. But thank you, Dan, for those two announcements, and thank you for those two servants of God that have served here. A couple other announcements and prayer concerns. First, we want to lift up Jeremy's grandmother, Jeremy Stewart, who, of course, works in sound here and also is a member here, and we're so grateful for him, and we want to pray for him and his family upon the loss of his grandmother. We also want to continue to pray for Daniela and her family as her grandmother continues to battle some health concerns unknown in the ICU in Jackson, Mississippi. So please keep both of their families in your prayers during this very difficult time, and them in your prayers. Also, Faith Doubleday lost her great aunt this week, and it's been very difficult on her family. So if you would pray for her family as well. But it's not all bad news. We've got some good news. Tonight it's Come Home to Bethlehem. Is anyone else excited about that? I certainly am. Yeah. Looking forward to Come Home to Bethlehem, and I want to give a big thank you to all of you who are volunteering to make that possible. It is such a huge contribution to our church, and we are eternally grateful for all that you're doing at Fountain City United Methodist Church. Also on Wednesday, we are welcoming a new class of confirmands here in the gym at 7 o'clock? 6:30. Sorry, correct me. 6:30. Be here at 6:30 if you would like to participate. I'd invite as many of you as possible to come to that to support our new confirmands. We're very excited to welcome them into our church family fully. So thanks be to God. We'll also be baptizing a family who attends the journey here on Wednesday, and that's Shannon and Rodney and their son Lucky Bello. We are so excited that they, the Dyers and Lucky, are going to be getting baptized, and we are so, so grateful for them. So let's give a round of applause for that as well. Before we enter our sermon this morning, will you bow your heads with me in an attitude of prayer? God, thank you for your humble servants, Daniel and Maxine. We are so grateful for their service to this community, and while we mourn their loss, we know that they are going on to better things, that Daniel will find a new opportunity that will allow him to grow even further, and Maxine will get to finally have that Sabbath of retirement. And God, we also give thanks for the confirmands and for the Dyer family and for Lucky and for everyone who is a member of this church that is faithfully serving us through this Come Home to Bethlehem experience, and for all those lives we hope to touch this evening. But God, we also recognize that there's pain, suffering, and death, and we pray for all those prayers that go spoken and unspoken in our hearts this morning. We pray for Daniela and for Jeremy as they struggle with the loss of Jeremy's grandmother and the continued battle of Daniela's grandmother. We pray for both of them and their families and them as a couple during this difficult time. We pray for safe travels back from Mississippi for Jeremy this morning, and we're so grateful for both of them in this service. And God, we also pray for Faith Doubleday upon this loss, and pray that you comfort and support her family through the power of your Holy Spirit. As we prepare to hear the truth of your gospel spoken this morning, incline our hearts to be one, our minds to be one, and the words of my lips to inspire meditations that are fulfilling and cause us as Christians to grow in faith with one another. All this we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Today's gospel lesson comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapters 39 through 55. In those days, Mary set out and went with haste to a Judean town in the hill country, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb." And why has this happened to me that the mother of my Lord comes to me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believes that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord. And Mary said, my soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown the strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever. This is the word of God for us, the beloved people of God. Thanks be to God. First of all, I found out this morning from my wife that it just so happens one of our Thrive groups is studying Mary during Advent. So please know that I did not write this sermon knowing that. This sermon came before knowing that that was the case. I'm not trying to steal your thunder or anything. But this morning I want to remind us of something. Over the course of the last 504 years or so since the Protestant Reformation, we Protestants have fallen into the habit of ignoring the second most important person in the Bible. And in doing so, we've lost touch with the true meaning of Advent, in my opinion. We have forgotten Christ's humanity, and we have forgotten the important role women have played in our church from its very foundations. That person, in case you hadn't already guessed, is Mary, our Savior's mother. Mary isn't just a mother, though. She's the prophet of all prophets. And see, Jesus is more than a prophet. Jesus is God incarnate. Jesus is the person who has come to liberate us. But Mary is the humble prophet that proclaims his coming. Like the prophets Isaiah and Elijah, Mary foretold the coming of a Messiah, sent to have all of creation saved. But unlike Elijah and Isaiah, Mary did this in a way that they couldn't. Mary did so with her very being. Mary did so with her body. She gave to God something so sacred, yet so taken for granted, that we often overlook it. She gave the entirety of her humanity. She bore the coming of a Messiah, not only in her words and deeds like the prophets before her, but she sacrificed her body and endured the pain of childbirth to bring God incarnate into this world, making a sacrifice the male prophets before her just couldn't make. And what a shame it is that we Protestants have forgotten Mary. In forgetting Mary, the mother of Jesus Christ, God incarnate in human flesh, real human flesh, pumping real human blood through his real human veins, even to this day when he's ascended into heaven, we have lost touch with Christ's humanity. We have lost touch with the God we worship being not only fully God in Jesus Christ, but also fully human. We forget God's ultimate prophet who is responsible for the humanity in Christ that we worship. Because we don't worship Jesus just as God, with no reverence for his humanity. No, we worship Christ holistically. Christ's divinity and Christ's humanity are inseparable. That is a foundational teaching of the church since the 4th century. Jesus isn't like the villain in Batman Two-Face, who's got like a good side and a bad side, one that's good and godly and the other that's wicked and human. No, Jesus is simultaneously fully human and divine, and we worship a whole God incarnate in human flesh, God-man in Jesus Christ. And I drive this point home because I think in our forgetting Mary, who is the source of Christ's humanity, we have stopped understanding the gospel fully. To understand the gospel, you must understand Christ as fully human and fully God. And you can't do that if you only ever focus on Christ's divinity without remembering his human mother, who passed down her human blood that he still pumps to this day to her beloved son. To put it another way, let me use the words of one of my favorite authors of the 20th century, and Maddie's going to laugh at me because she knows exactly where this is going, Flannery O'Connor. As Bishop Robert Barron points out, O'Connor was the master of symbolism in 20th century American writing, specifically in the Southern Gothic genre. Her short stories and her two novels, through the use of allegory and symbolism, cut to the heart of the cultural dysfunctions and many seemingly contradictory beauties of the American South, where racism was still prevalent in her day in the early to mid-1960s when she was being published. But once, while at a dinner party of a fellow author who was a professed atheist, her host said something along the lines of, "If I had one favorite thing you Christians do, it's that cute little symbol of Holy Communion." To which Flannery O'Connor, a devout Roman Catholic, said, and excuse, I'm quoting here, "If communion is just a symbol, then to hell with it." If communion is just a symbol, well, then to hell with it. How powerful are those words, right? And how this quote might also apply to Mary. If Mary's just another human, if Mary's just another prophet standing on the corner holding a sign, well, then to heck with her. Not only that, if we forget Jesus' human mother, it becomes far too easy for us as Christians to say, well, to heck with Christ's humanity, when it is exactly the humanity of Christ, of our God, that makes us unique from other religions and proclaims the universal love and grace beyond human conception of our triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And what I think is most prevalent of all in forgetting Mary is that if we forget her, it becomes far too easy for us to say, well, to heck with women. To heck with women in the church. To heck with women from the pulpit. And as someone who was raised in the South, in a context where I was surrounded by fervent anti-Catholic fundamentalist Baptists who taught me to fear people who were different than me and who said women couldn't stand up from the pulpit, women couldn't wear pants to church, I can tell you that in forgetting Mary, that mindset is far more common than we think it might be. And here in the United Methodist Church, we have the added benefit of ordaining women, yes, but women pastors in the United Methodist Church still face sexual harassment, they face belittling, they face condescension, they face parishioners who don't take them seriously because they are women. So we are not exempt from this just because we ordain women. It exists in our church, and I think our forgetting Mary is a big theological part of why that has happened. I chose to preach on Mary and the Magnificat on this week of Advent, because I also wanted to send a message to the women in this room that if it were not for a young girl in first century Roman Palestine who was pregnant out of wedlock, we would not be gathering here today. If it were not for God's chief prophet being a young woman living in a town called Nazareth that was seen as poor and disgusting and trashy, and a place of debauchery, Christianity and our salvation wouldn't have happened. Advent is the season of the expectant mother. We stand not alongside Christ in Advent, because in our dramatic retelling of Christ's story that we call the liturgical calendar, Christ has not yet come in Advent. We're expecting Christ. We're yearning for Christ in Advent. And we get those readings of Jesus at Christmas, and trust me, I'm right there with you, yearning for those readings, and that's the spirit of Advent. But if we want to understand Advent, we need to understand that we walk in eager anticipation alongside a young woman who would have been outcast from her society for being pregnant outside of marriage. Even though that she proclaimed that she was a virgin, even though she claimed that the child was God's. I'm sure many people in Nazareth went, huh, We've heard people say that before. As the child of a young, unmarried single mother who lived in a context in the South where my mom faced very similar judgment, shame, and exclusion, Advent is my season of peace because God reminds me and mothers and women everywhere that although society judges women, although society has tried to eliminate accepting spaces for single or unwed expectant mothers, God chose a woman not so dissimilar from my own to bear God into the world, Jesus Christ. Not only that, we worship a human full of divinity who society said before he was even born that he didn't belong here, that he'd be better off not in this world because he was the child of a single mother. Advent is a season of anticipation. We're walking with God's chief prophet in all of Scripture, Mary, walking alongside her and hoping that when Jesus comes again, we may love God incarnate in human flesh, Jesus, just an ounce as much as his mother did. Let us find peace in that. Let us find peace in our waiting. I want to close out our sermon today with a very famous prayer, whose English translation in common use is from the King James Version of the Magnificat that we read from the Gospel of Luke today. And I read this to you because I want to recognize the place of women in our church and in the Advent season. I pray this prayer often because I need as many people praying for me as I can to stay on the straight and narrow path. I read this prayer from the Gospel of Luke because it has brought me, the child of a poor, young, unwed mother, peace during the Advent season. I pray this prayer often for my mother and for single mothers everywhere who have been told by the church and by the world that they and their children don't belong, when in reality, God chose someone almost exactly like them to birth Jesus Christ into the world. And as I invite the band up, let me say these words that Seth shared with me this week from Dietrich Bonhoeffer before I say this prayer, because I think it gets to the heart in part of what I'm trying to say. Advent is possible only to those who are troubled in soul, who know themselves to be poor and imperfect, and who look forward to something greater to come. So hear this prayer with me. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our deaths. Amen.
If you would, let's stand for this last song. I love to see little God moments. And one God moment I want to share with you is I really didn't read through the scripture this week, the scripture lesson. But the last song that I chose goes exactly with it. So thank you, God, for showing off. It's called Glory Revealed. Voice cries in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Hang on just a second. Check one, that's better. Jeremy Stewart, I really miss you. Voice cries in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. And make straight in the desert a highway for our God. And every valley will be raised, and every mountain peak made low, and the ground it will be level, and the rough places smooth. Then we will see the glory of the Lord. Yeah, all eyes will see the glory of the Lord revealed. Oh, the glory of our Lord revealed. A voice cries in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert highway for our God. And every valley will be raised, and every mountain be made low, and the ground it will be level, and the rough places smooth. Strength saying, see your God, behold, he comes in power. Then we will see the glory of the Lord. Yeah, all eyes will see the glory of the Lord. Chase, come on up here and do our benediction for us. Hang on. Testing. I'm not sure what's going on with this thing today. Yeah, go ahead and do it. Just go ahead and use my mic there. Sorry about that, y'all.
There we go. Okay. Well, we have come to the end of this worship service, and there is one more announcement I want to make. Kim Mead is looking for some jackets for Central High School students. A lot of them are migrants and are experiencing winter for the first time and cannot afford jackets. So if you would like to donate a jacket, please reach out to Kim Mead, and if you need her number, you can call the church office and get that. But hear this benediction. Go now knowing that God chose a prophet to bring into this world Jesus Christ, not who was high and exalted or rich and famous, but a poor young woman from a little town called Nazareth. And that she is the person we should have reverence for when we remember the role of women in our church. So go now in the name of the Father and the Son of the Holy Spirit, never forgetting the Blessed Mother. Amen.
Amen.